if we're going to understand the end times. And number one, one of the things we have to understand is where Israel's place is in the end times. And then the next thing that we have to understand is that the church has not replaced Israel. Okay? Israel is still the apple of God's eyes, and I see him one good push up another button right quick. I need a button pusher up here. Sons of Abraham, if we anybody else that's not supporting Israel. And it ought to scare any of us. This is why, this verse right here is why we need to support Israel. This is why we need to pray for Israel. This is why we need to support Israel. This is why our nation's leaders need to stand with Israel. He said, I will make you a great nation and will bless you and make your name great, and ye shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you will I curse. And in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. And so, you see, Israel is God's chosen people. We have the thought or the mindset that it's all about the church. It's all about us. But guess what? It's not. God loves us. Jesus died for us. But Israel is the apple of his eye. And he's got an everlasting covenant with Israel. Guess what? He's not going to break that covenant with Israel. And so, you know, as they talk about, Israel is the center of the world. Every part of prophecy that takes place centers around Israel. And if you, I don't know if you caught it or not, but you know, no prophecies were fulfilled while Israel was not a nation. No prophecies concerning the end times were fulfilled from like 141 A.D. to the 20th century. No prophecies were fulfilled, but as soon as Israel became a nation in one day, which was prophesied, the greatest fulfillment of prophecy ever, that's when the prophetic time clock started back, and now we see this escalation of end time events coming. And so, you know, Israel has turned against God, and well, they haven't turned against God, but they don't believe Jesus Christ was the Messiah. They believe he was, a false prophet, or just a mere man. And so they rejected him. But you see, what's going to happen, and we need to understand this too. The church, when God gets through with the church, when the last Gentile has come into the fold, and who is a Gentile? If you're not a Jew, guess what you are? A Gentile. And God knows the exact number of people that are going to be saved.
Amen.
And when that number comes, then that's it. He's going to turn his focus from the church by taking them up to glory in the rapture. And he's going to set his attention back on Israel. And that's how Paul can say in Romans, all Israel will be saved. Now, what is he talking about there? All Israel will be saved. Is that all Israelites that ever lived will be saved? Absolutely not. Does it mean that all Israelites that do a certain thing will be accepted? No. But all the Israelites will be saved during the time of the tribulation. They're going to realize that the Messiah that they rejected was really Jesus. It was him, because Revelation says when he comes back, every eye will see him, even the ones that pierced him. Even the soldier that pierced him will see him and know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it was Jesus Christ. It was the Messiah. You see, in between that time, you know, like our slide here says, if I push the right arrow, Jesus came and he was rejected. He wanted them to accept him as Messiah, but they didn't. And so what's going to happen next is the tribulation. And before the great tribulation happens, I believe the church will be raptured away. Like I said, when the last Gentile, his name is called on that roll in heaven, then God is going to meet him in the sky. And it will be changed in twinkling of an eye if we're there, if we're not dead. But then when the people are left on earth, when he turns his focus upon Israel, is going to be the time of the great tribulation. And people are so confused about the tribulation. What is a tribulation? Why do we even need a tribulation? Why did God make a tribulation? It's because some people are just a little bit hard-headed. What did he say about you? Just about that much. not only going to be upon Israel, it's going to be upon everybody that has not believed in Jesus when he comes back for his church. You'll be left behind, like Tim LaHaye, the man we've been watching, who wrote all the Left Behind books. If you don't believe in Jesus when he comes for his church, and like I said, the second coming of Jesus Christ is made up of two parts. What are they? Anybody know? Part one is what? The rapture. Part two is what? When his feet touches the Mount of Olives. Now, during that first part of his second coming, we're going to be gone. Mount Zion is going to be shut down. They can do whatever they want to. This building turns into a casino or whatever they want to do. We're going to be gone. But the people left behind are going to face a severe persecution. And it's going to boil down to a final war, which is going to come at a place called Jezreel. And it says in Revelation 16:16, now the spirits gathered the kings and the armies to a place that is called Armageddon in Hebrew. This is the Valley of Jezreel. Okay? And I've got an interesting piece here from Victor Matthews. He says that the Valley of Jezreel gets its name from the town of Jezreel at the east end of the valley. It's a fertile plain that divides the Carmel Range from the lower pass between the hill of Morah and Mount Gilboa into the Jordan Valley, and it ranges from 5 to 10 miles wide across, and it's 15 miles in length. It was a major trade route, and they got a lot of iron out of there, and that was the word for iron, and it's called Megiddo. And the translation from Hebrew is Armageddon with an H. And so they just finally called it the Valley of Armageddon. And in Revelation, it says they will meet at a place called Armageddon in Hebrew. And so this final war will come to pass. And when that war comes to pass, guess who's coming back? It's Jesus Christ. He's coming back. That's the second part of his second coming. Guess who's coming with him? Me. Hallelujah. I'm coming with him. We're going to be with him. And when Jesus Christ, when his feet touch down on that Mount of Olives, says, that's just more about Armageddon. Says here, then the Lord will go to battle and fight against the nations, just as he fought in the ancient days. And on that day will stand, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which lies east of Jerusalem, and the Mount of Olives will be split in half from east to west, leaving a great valley. And that means what? Jesus Christ is here. What's he going to do when he gets here? What are we going to do with him when we get here? We're going to do a few things. Well, number one, we're going to inaugurate a new kingdom. We're going to establish a kingdom. How long is this kingdom going to last? 1,000 years. What's this kingdom called?
Millennial.
Millennial kingdom. Yeah, what does the word millennial mean? 1,000. So God, Jesus Christ, is going to set up his millennial kingdom. Okay? He's going to set up, and we are going to rule with him. And it'll be 24 elders, and you know it's been debated, but I believe it'll be the 12 apostles and the 12 patriarchs of the 12 tribes, the 24 elders, and the church will rule and reign with Jesus Christ. And at that time, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. It's at that time that WWE's controversial passage talks about one will be grinding at the mill, and will be taken, other will be left behind. One will be in the bed and taken, other will be left behind. Everybody thinks that's about the rapture, but that's not. That's about the second coming of Jesus Christ into his millennial kingdom. See, when he comes back for his millennial kingdom, it's going to be just like when he comes for his people in the rapture. It's going to be like a thief in the night. And see, he's coming, he's taking the one into judgment, not in the rapture, because they, in Matthew, where that comes from, they don't even know about the church. Church didn't exist. Nobody ever heard of the church. So he's talking about what all Jewish people knew. All the Jewish people knew about the second coming of Christ. No Jewish people knew about the rapture. So when one is taken and one's left behind, where they're taken to is judgment. Where the carcasses, where the God and Satan, good and evil. And all the human beings who are alive during the millennium will have to make that choice. And if anybody's read past chapter 20, verse 3, knows that it doesn't take Satan long to build up a big old following. So, man, we are out of time as usual. But, so, let me just summarize by saying this, okay, because we got to quit here pretty quickly. Number one, Israel is the apple of God's eyes.
Always will be.
And always will be. There's nothing we can do to change that. If we say that God will break his covenant, that means God is untrustworthy. And I can trust my God. You can trust your God. He's trustworthy. He's immutable. He's immovable. He's unchanging in his ways and in his word. And if he says that he's got an everlasting covenant with Israel, nothing can take the place of that. A lot of people today want to say that the church has taken the place of Israel. But if the church has taken the place of Israel, what do we need the tribulation for? What's all that about? And if it's, you know... It just doesn't make sense to me. Because we got to remember, if we just keep those two things in mind, we got to know that the focus is on Israel. All prophecy revolves around Israel. Everything about the end times revolves around Israel. It's the center of the world, just like we heard. And the thing is that the church didn't take the place of Israel. See, the thing is that when the Messiah came that the Jews had so long anticipated and expected, he didn't come like they thought he would come. Kind of like a lot of churches. Not this one, of course, but some churches, they get new members in and they don't look like the rest of the members, so they don't want nothing to do with them. Or some churches get people in that don't talk like the rest of them, and they don't want them. Thank goodness that's not Mount Zion. And that's what happened. Here comes Jesus, and he's like, you know, I'll tell you one thing Jesus was a smart aleck. You know, if you read the Bible, Jesus was kind of smart mouth.
From Nazareth?
Yeah. And from Nazareth. What good thing can come from Nazareth?
Right.
Yeah, and so, but he said all these things being a smart aleck and using hyperbole, you know, these exaggerated, like you got a hatred mom to follow me and all this. He used all these exaggerations of expressions to get their attention. That's what he wanted. He wanted their attention, but they rejected it. And so by Israel's rejection, I think Paul put it this way. If Israel's rejection can cause us so much good to happen to us, what in the world is it going to be like when Israel receives it? I mean, it's going to be, that's the ultimate climax of history. It's when all Israel is saved. And there will be other people saved out of the tribulation too. In Revelation it said, John said, who are these? No, the angel said, John, who are these? And he's like, I don't know, who are they? He said, these are the, and there's an innumerable multitude, and these are the ones that washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb during the tribulation. So people will be saved during the tribulation, but think about this. Lord, I'm running over. Hey, it's hard to quit talking when I want to tell you this stuff. But think how hard it is now for somebody to walk up that aisle and say, you know what? I just received Jesus. I think about Brandy. She received the Lord this Sunday, and that just blessed my heart. But think about how hard that was for a teenage girl to come up here and say and tell me that I want him, you know. And then she told y'all that she had him. Okay. Think how hard that is. And now we've got the Holy Spirit here. We've got the church here, and Michael, the archangel, and all the other angels are fighting spiritual battles all around us that we don't even know about. During the time of the Great Tribulation, the church is different things. So imagine how hard it's going to be to accept Jesus then. And if you do accept him, it's probably a death sentence for you because of the Antichrist.
One thing too, though, if you take the mark of the beast, you cannot be saved. Mm-hmm. So you have to make a difference there.
Yeah, you have to be able to withstand. I mean, and that's even, that adds another dynamic to it. You know, you gotta, in order not to accept the mark of the beast, you better have a big garden. Because you won't be able to buy food or you wouldn't be able to do anything. But, you know, some will escape to Petra, but that's for another. Yeah, that's my cue to. I'll tell you, this is my greatest joy right here is teaching about prophecy, and I put a lot of time in it, maybe a little bit more than I should compared to other things sometimes, but it's a passion. It's my passion, and I think we need to know about this stuff, and I think we need to learn all we can, and the reason we need to do that is because we want to see our people saved. We don't want to see anybody left behind, and we need to stand with Israel because I want
That's
to
right.
be blessed
That's right.
and not cursed. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for this day and all your blessings. Lord, we thank you so much for your word and just the way you are, Lord. We know you cannot go against your word. It's not in you to lie. It's not in you to break a promise, Lord, and you've given us some great promises, Lord. And I just cannot say it enough what Paul said, you know, just to thank all the good that came about by Israel rejecting you and to know one day that they're going to receive you. I just can't imagine the goodness and the greatness that's going to come out of that, Lord. I just thank you that I'm saved and I'm going to be able to have a front seat watching that tribulation, and I'll be able to ride back with you, following you on that white war horse to come back and set up your millennial kingdom, Lord, and then we'll have a place to rule and reign with you, Father. So, Lord, in the meantime, help us to live our lives according to your will and lead as many people to Jesus as we can, so when you come back, you'll find us doing just what we're supposed to be doing. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.